my presentation will be based on results of the study, which was completed literally a few days ago. That is why I've just hardly had time to make this PowerPoint presentation, because I've got the results from Moscow like about 5 or 6 days ago. And I think it's a good idea to present it, to share with the professional community. In fact, that's probably among the first presentations. Actually, it's the second presentation. The first was yesterday in Boston. It was never published before. I'm talking about a research which was committed and funded by the Russian Jewish Congress and fulfilled by the Levada Center, one of the most respectable public opinion studies centers in Moscow, in Russia. And I think the results are pretty interesting to my mind, interesting enough in order to share it with the respectable academic and the professional community. So I will say a few words about research itself. It consists of a quantitative study, meaning their opinion poll, of Jewish and non-Jewish population in the Russian Federation. It's not ready yet, but what is ready is actually a qualitative study, meaning the series of the focus groups, meetings with the various groups representing four categories of contemporary non-Jewish population in Russia, including the so-called young and adult representatives of the Moscow population, big population center, and young and adult population of the provincial centers, Muslims and Christians. So we have for quite a spectrum of the local society, good enough in order to come to the conclusions what really the contemporary Russian society thinks about Jews, whether this society is anti-Semitic or whether it's philo-Semitic or whether it's asymmetric, means they're not open anti-Semites, but in fact anti-Semitism is something which at the moment doesn't exist in the operative field, but is a part of the local societal culture. Latent anti-Semitism, or suppressed anti-Semitism, I would say, yeah? Which is different. By the way, you are welcome to ask questions in the middle. That's fine, absolutely fine. It will even help me. We have two definitions of anti-Semitism in Russia, meaning the government anti-Semitism or state anti-Semitism and societal or day-to-day anti-Semitism. Now we understand that we have something in between. Meaning it's not the government anti-Semitism. Officially, the state anti-Semitism was abolished in Russia in March 1990, 26 years ago sharp. When I prepared my book about Jewish emigration from Russia in Ukraine, we actually succeeded to find a document in the former archive of the Communist Party and a couple of documents in the former KGB archives, and we know that anti-Semitism officially was finished in Russia 26 years ago according to the decision of the Political Bureau of the Central Committee of the Communist Party, yeah, which is something which is decided by the government, okay? Since then, we are used to believe that anti-Semitism, anti-Semitic exclamations, you know, and approaches dramatically decreased in the post-Soviet states because there was no support of the government, and the society proved to be less anti-Semitic as it used to be because of the support of the government, you know, or official anti-Semitic or in the quotation marks, anti-Zionist propaganda of the Soviet authorities. But now we understand that quite a century passed, and in fact, it's really a part of the inner feelings, societal culture of the Russian society, and not only Russian society. So our question is whether it's really something that should be defined as a problem for the existence of Jewry there, or should not be defined as a problem. Whether it's a, should it be problem or should not it be, it also depends on the fact whether Jews exist in Russia, the Jewish community does exist in Russia. I had a question before the beginning of the session, so whether Jewish community does exist there. In the demographic terms, still we have probably the sixth or seventh biggest Jewish community in the world in the post-Soviet states. we still have for something like 350,000 people that could be defined as Jews according to religious law, meaning according to Halacha. And according to Israeli law return, we have between 700,000 to 800,000 people. That means that could be both a subject of emigration, including Aliyah to Israel, and what we call revival of organized Jewish life in the post-Soviet states. Probably something like between 500,000 to 550,000 people live in Russia, two-thirds of them in two big population centers, meaning Moscow and St. Petersburg. So this question whether there is a sort of a combination of suppressed or latent, as you say, anti-Semitic approaches within the government and educated intellectual Russian society in this big industrial and culture centers, is that the question whether there is a future for the local Jewish community, I would say. Okay, so let me start with something which normally people prefer to finish, with a conclusion. So my conclusion is the following, and also conclusion of this research, which I was a member of the so-called observatory or a steering committee on the behalf of Ukraine, Israeli colleagues, I would say. So the general conclusion is the following. If we are talking about anti-Semitism, well, in fact, as you know, this is an unequivocal question. Anti-Semitism, in fact, is a subjective matter. There is an anti-Semitism that you could live with and that you cannot live with. And whether you could live or not could live with that is the question how you see the situation. More objective definition of the story is what are the challenges and risks for the Jewish population that could be defined problematic enough in order to say that there is an anti-Semitic inclinations or anti-Semitic trends in this or that country. So in Russia we have the following. The actual level of the challenges and risks in concern vis-a-vis the Jewish community is relatively, is not high, is relatively low. The spontaneous increase of this level of challenges and risks is pretty unlikely in the nearest future. However, the return of the state anti-Semitism, if it will come back, could be, meaning the provocation of anti-Semitic events and actions through their mass media or bureaucratic activities, could be the mostly problematic in concern of the local society. At the moment, it is also pretty unlikely, but it also could come in future. That's the major decision, major conclusion. So at the moment, we don't see a problem, but nobody gives a guarantee that it will not come back in future. So saying that, now I will use the next 40-45 minutes in order to prove this conclusion, what really going on and what happens. Okay, let me start with saying a few words about the contemporary political culture in the Russian Federation. As you know, ladies and gentlemen, dear colleagues, contemporary Russia under the presidency of Vladimir Putin is in fact a combination, or I would say the official ideology of the government and the state is in fact a combination of three major narratives, meaning the pre-revolutionary, pre-1917 Tsarist Russia narrative. Second is the Soviet narrative. And the third is contemporary Western liberal post-Soviet narrative. So current Russian government and current Russian power authorities see themselves as the descendants of all three models, you know. They actually insist that Russia is a descendant of the strong Russian Empire, which would never lose the First World War and will be among the those who gain victory in the First World War, among those who will decide the future of this world if the Bolshevik Revolution would not stop it. On the other hand, they also, the contemporary Russia, is also a descendant of the Bolshevik regime, of the communist regime, which made industrialization, culture revolution, made Soviet Union one of the superpowers, and so on and so forth. It's pretty important for a contemporary Russian regime, which is interested to return to the international political arena as one of the two or three major superpowers, which became quite visible under the presidency of Vladimir Putin and Medvedev, and Dmitry Medvedev. And the third, at the same time, contemporary regime is also a descendant of the democratic movement in Russia, of dissident movement, of those who are looking for establishment of the democratic liberal and so on and so forth. So how all these three approaches could live together, it's a good question. But meantime, in concern of the official ideology, that what happens. In the present day Russia, it is called the so-called sovereign democracy. That means a specific Russian model of democracy, which first of all poses the question of, or stresses the question of sovereignty and specific Russian way of development. Which, of course, in the practical terms means that Russia is interested to be not just the regional superpower, meaning to dominate within the framework of the former Soviet Union, but also return its status in Europe, in the international arena, in the Middle East, that what we see, that what we observe now. Okay, if we will come back to all the three narratives, we should take into account that each of these approaches have the also their tradition of anti-Semitism. There was an anti-Semitism in the Tsarist Russia, there was anti-Semitism in the Soviet Union, and there is a sort of anti-Semitism in contemporary Russian democratic or sovereign democratic post-Soviet states. Concerning the Tsarist Russia, you know that it was a classical anti-Semitism based on the religious approach, with the Pale of Settlement, with the discrimination, banning the certain professions, joining the universities or educational establishments, getting the government jobs, and so on and so forth. But this oppression and discrimination could be immediately stopped in case Jew was ready to convert into Christianity or any other religion. In the Soviet case, in the Soviet period, we have, first of all, the so-called emancipation of Jews, abolishing the Pale of Settlement, opening of opportunities in concerning the job, education, and so on and so forth, but return to the state anti-Semitism at the end of the Stalinist era and continuation in the era of Khrushchev, Khrushchev and especially Brezhnev, and that, until the end of the Soviet period. Opposite to what we had, what we observed in the Tsarist times, the Soviet-style anti-Semitism was based vis-a-vis background of ethnicity rather than religion. Means if the, in the Tsarist period, pre-revolutionary Russia, for Jew it was enough to convert, in the Soviet period it was not enough for Jew to convert into the communist ideology or sort of a civil religion which replaced or was going to replace the Christianity as an official religion, if you define communism as a sort of the civil religion. Yeah. It was not enough by the end of the Soviet period to be converted into the communism and even to become a member of the Communist Party and identify with the Soviet values and so on and so forth. But it's pretty enough that, that a person was born Jewish. And in fact, by the end of the Soviet period, it was pretty clear that physical, ethnic, cultural survival for a Jew meant three options. Either to assimilate and forget about Jewish roots, changing their conscription in internal documents, or to emigrate to the countries where the Jew, a Jew could be Jewish, either in the West or make Aliyah to Israel, or to combine these two approaches and fight for being Jewish in the Soviet Union, meaning to participate in the national Jewish movement. I would say that number three stream, meaning contemporary quasi or semi or in fact liberal element of the political and ideological, ideological narrative, is in fact has its own anti-Semitic component. Of course, the official Russian authorities, they are not anti-Semitic. They are the official anti-Semitism was abolished 26 years ago. In fact, they keep this approach even now. But we have new models of anti-Semitism, or political, media, cultural, and societal. Let me say a few words about each of them, probably. Okay. Nevertheless, let's start with the fact that despite everything we are talking about, in spite despite of the fact that we have for so-called, as we define it, asymmetric, means neither anti-Semitic but not pro-Semitic, you know, asymmetric approach, which is the part of the public culture, well, Russia still could be defined as their island of security for Jews. If you will compare in terms of classical anti-Semitism, if we will compare it with what is going on in countries like Denmark, Sweden, France, Belgium, even Britain, so the number of anti-Semitic incidents or incidents that could be defined as something which has happened according to the xenophobic and anti-Semitic background is a pretty lower. Please have a look at this graph. You will see that, for instance, the number of the incidents just recently that happened in the whole 2015 in Russia is not more than three dozens, you know. We are talking about all sorts of anti-Semitism, including insultment, attacks, physical activities, and so on and so forth. If we will take the number of victims, it's constantly decreasing. It wasn't very high, it was less than 100 in 2013 and became even less in 2014 and three times less than 2 years ago in 2015. If we will have a look, compare two countries, these two countries are fight with each other for the status of the most anti-Semitic, meaning in the Soviet times to be anti-Semitic was to be as a sort of a pride, but now it's a sort of a tool to fight the enemy, you know. The official Russian propaganda defines Ukraine as the Ukrainian regime as an anti-Semitic and vice versa, you know, due to the conflict between these two post-Soviet republics. We will have, for instance, if we are talking about one of the examples, the most obvious, anti-Semitic vandalism, meaning their abuse and vandalism on all the Jewish institutions, cemeteries, synagogues, educational establishments, community centers, and so on and so forth. You can see that it's not more than 10 to 12 in Russia in the recent years, and in Ukraine, it was constantly decreasing since the mid early first decade of early this century and until the eve of the so-called the revolution of dignity in Ukraine. That means the recent events in 2013 on the eve of it. And the two recent years, 2014 and 2015, actually we see the increase of these events, which are still, you know, 23, 22, but still, you know, everything is publicized, everything in the media, everything on TV, it draws a lot of attention, so it becomes their phenomena, which are part of the public discourse, you know. That happens due to, you know, you will, ladies and gentlemen, found the politically correct definition of what is going on. Some say it's Russian-Ukrainian war, some say it's a civil war in Ukraine, some say it's riots against fascist regime in Kiev. Some would say the struggle of Ukrainian people for democracy and liberalism against the agents of the imperialistic regime in Moscow. So, okay, I'm not talking about how to define it, but we all understand what we are talking about. So, in the recent 2 years, many explain that the increase of number of the vandalism is a result of the fact that the level, the red line of what is possible is climbing down. Meaning if for those who do not love Jews, in the quotation marks, but were not permitted themselves to do something which goes, which crosses this red line. At the moment, since the country is in war, people permit themselves and see every day what is going on in the battlefield and see refugees and people are dead and wounded and displaced and so on and so forth. So society from time to time permits or accepts as acceptable, sees as acceptable something which was not acceptable a couple of years ago. But still you can see that it's not so great increase. If you will have a look, the number of, in red you can see here, the number of registered acts of anti-Semitic vandalism, and in white or yellow, light yellow, you can see here the number of those who were victims of this anti-Semitic incidents. You see that in spite of the fact that the number of acts actually increasing, the number of those who were damaged are actually decreasing. So that means that in spite of everything, the level of anti-Semitic xenophobia is decreasing in Russia and Ukraine, and you can also see it here. Let me explain briefly why that happens. We have a few reasons for that. The first reason is actually due to the fact that the Jewish population decreased. Very simple. The less interface you have, the less reasons for expression your xenophobia you should have. The second reason is that Jews as the major internal enemy was replaced by somebody else. Migrant from Caucasus, United States, by the way, or the West in general, migrants from the Central Asia, Europeans who imposed sanctions against Russian regime, and so on and so forth. The Jews became less important for mobilization of so-called Russian patriotism and solidarity against somebody, against the enemy, than it might be or used to be quite years before. If we will have a look. Of course, for each region, that's different. For Russia, it's they are Muslim migrants and the West. For Ukraine, that's Imperial Russia. As you understand, that's the major enemy. For Armenia and Azerbaijan, they're enemies of each other. You know, it's much more important than to look for a search for a Jewish enemy. So at the moment, that's probably a reason why Jews are much less visible from this point of view as it used to be before. The third question, by the way, if you will have this picture of this guy, his name is Vladislav Surkov. He is actually a typical representative of contemporary Russian intellectuals, intelligentsia, one of their key members of the inner circle of Vladimir Putin and the founder of the idea of the concept of the sovereign democracy. Why his picture is here? Not just to show how he's important for the establishment of the contemporary official government political narrative in the modern Russia, but also as a poet, quite an educated and cultural guy, who actually good representative of the Russian intelligentsia. Opposite to what we see in Western Europe, that West European left-wing intellectuals, then were they one of those, among those who actually move forward the anti-Zionist, that means anti-Semitic / anti-Semitic exclamations and activities. Russia, I spoke to people in his team, and ask them, what's the story? You know, now we are talking about the influence of Western ideas on the Russian society, and especially on the Russian intellectual establishment. What about West European intellectual anti-Semitism? And they told me that probably will be the last European value they are going to adopt. You know, at some stage it will come probably, but not now, and maybe not at all. So from this point of view, the intellectual elite is not anti-Semitic. Opposite to what we see, unfortunately, in many other European countries. Then the fourth reason I would say that Russia, in spite of the fact that it has probably the biggest Muslim population in Europe, something like 36 or 37 million Russian citizens are actually belong to ethnic Muslims, you know. That doesn't necessarily mean that all of them, or even majority of them, they keep Muslim commandments, but they came from the Muslim background, okay, if you understand what I mean. So opposite to Muslim communities, established Muslim communities in London, Paris, Berlin, Malmö, and so on and so forth. For the Muslim communities in the former Soviet Union, anti-Semitism is not something, Muslim communities are not so concentrated or organized around the idea of struggle with Zionism / anti-Semitism. Despite of the fact that it's going to be changed, it's in the process of change even now, but not because of the fact that it comes from within, but actually because of the external influence much more. So there are a substantial part of the Russian Muslim establishment, meaning their preachers, their clerics, Muslim community leaders, and so on and so forth. Many of them got education in the Middle East, in Turkey, in Saudi Arabia, in Qatar, in some other institutions. So they come and bring together with them the ideas of radical Islam. Their teaching in the mosques are sometimes pretty radical. Many of them were involved into recruitment of their resources and people for the extremist movement like Al-Qaeda, like Daesh. How we say Daesh? Islamic State, yeah? Here. As you can see, just a second, as you can see, for the first time last year, in 2015, a Muslim cleric was in fact brought before court and convicted for anti-Semitic preaching. It never happened before, but that's probably the beginning. There is a difference between the Muslim communities and the big population centers. Despite of the fact that they are more visible and most of the critic concerning the activities of Islamic communities and Muslim activists here actually deals with what they do in Moscow, St. Petersburg, but in fact it's a small problem there. The biggest problem are actually in their ethnic areas, and many of the local elite are trying to mobilize these feelings in order to strengthen their regional power vis-a-vis their so-called imperial power in Moscow. I'm not even talking about Caucasus like Chechnya and so on. I'm talking about the Volga area and so on, if you understand what I mean. Okay. Do you recognize this macho? This is Mr. Vladimir Putin, the president of Russian Federation, the Russian Federation. And here you create three pictures, actually one of the most popular pictures in the public media in Russia in the recent years. The guy who is everything he's doing by himself. Hunting, commanding, flying, swimming, that's the leader. Very different from this gerontocratia, of the Soviet time, of the Politburo, where people were sitting that around plus minus 80. That's really the new type leader. Energetic, clever, strong. Here you can see in the right hand Vladimir Putin on the press conference after the appending of Crimea into Russian Federation. Or return of the Crimea, as they define it. You choose the politically correct word for that. In the middle, you see Vladimir Putin actually meeting the representatives of the public organizations. So you see different NGOs, religious institutions, Orthodox Church, Jewish leaders, Muslim leaders, and you can see from this picture who is the boss. Okay, one of the reasons why anti-Semitism is relatively lower in the Russian Federation is that the government is not ready to tolerate any form of public activity which is not accepted by the authorities. Meaning, like in this, it's a proper continuation of the Soviet tradition. In the Soviet Union as well, the government was anti-Semitic, but it suppressed the unauthorized anti-Semitic activities. That means everything which is not authorized is not accepted, should not be tolerated. So contemporary Russian government is not anti-Semitic. Mr. Putin, personally, he's not anti-Semite. Okay, not at all. Different people with a different worldview and different vision are, in fact, might have all sorts of understanding and vision concerning the Jewry. But at the moment, there is a official choice that regime is tolerant to Jews, that the government accepts the Jewish institutions, Jewish identity, solidarity of the local Jewry with Israel, supports the synagogues, schools, and kindergartens, and so on and so forth. As you remember, Mr. Putin a few years ago openly and publicly donated his 2 months' salary for establishment of the Jewish Culture and Holocaust Commemoration Center. So, and also mentioned that probably other members of my government might consider doing the same. In fact, from this point of view, we can say that one of the reasons why anti-Semitism, anti-Semitic feelings and activities are not so widespread, there is the position of the government. Yes, sir. Okay. The short answer is that you can see this. The question is how we could define or explain that in spite of everything which is said, why the Russian government is extremely aggressive against Ukraine, using their or accusing the Ukrainian government on anti-Semitism. As you can see from this poster, we are sitting in the event which is organized by the Institute of Study of Anti-Semitism and Policy. So I would say it's much more policy than anti-Semitism, meaning if in the previous periods one of the important tools of mobilization of public support was, you know, negative approach to Jews. Now one of the models or one of the ways to mobilize international activity, support and local legitimization is to say that the other side is anti-Semitic. So the same we see in Kyiv. Okay, they're trying to explain the Russian power is anti-Semitic and they accuse the pro-Russian activists or Russian troops, if there are Russian troops in eastern Ukraine, as responsible for this anti-Semitic acts and vandalism and so on and so forth. So that's my explanation, probably. Okay. Whether we should see it as the end of the problem or it's just the start of the problem. That's probably, let me quote one of our respondents who said, as you can see here, today the state is strong and it deals against such anti-Semitic intentions, but if the straps of the state would weaken one day, anything could happen. Ethnic question is a very problematic one in contemporary Russia. Okay, that means that we have a substantial problem here. At the moment, the state is favorable to Jews. Jewish history knows a lot of examples like that, where the Jews were invited to Poland, to Europe, in order to help to build up ideology, culture, economy, education. And then when the government was came to the conclusion that Jews are done, you know, and contributed what they were able to contribute, and now it's much more convenient and profitable to change the policy will be changed. And the question is whether this change of policy will find an understanding in the eyes of the entire society. So many of our respondents believe that they will find a positive response in this case. So asymitism could easily become societal anti-Semitism. But meantime, it doesn't happen. It still never happened. You know, and the final reason I would say, we are talking about OFL reasons. Is everything meantime, at least meantime, for the time being, is so nice and rose, like you may conclude from my presentation? Of course not. The problem is that actually the background preconditions for transformation of anti-Semitic feelings into anti-Semitic feelings are actually there. And many researchers believe that between 8 to 10% of the Russian society is actually construct the strong core of classical for classical anti-Semitism. We see their dimensions of that. possibilities for that due to or through all sorts of anti-Semitic events that take place in Russia, Ukraine, and some other places in the former Soviet Union. As a researchers, we like, you know, to make a typology of different sorts of anti-Semitism. So let's start with their crimes that inspired by Judaphobia. Among them are graffiti and swastikas, all sorts of inscriptions on the various Jewish constructions. Here you see three typical examples for that. In this audience, I believe I should not explain what Babi Yar is. I believe. Here you see there one of the commemoration stones in the Babi Yar. And somebody wrote a swastika on that. So this is a representation of the new right or neo-fascist ideology, which found an address in the modern symbols of contemporary Jewry. As you know, understanding of Holocaust as Babi Yar events like Babi Yar events, or massacres of the local population by the Nazis, understanding or defining, redefining of it, or as their exclusively or predominantly Jewish affair or a part of the Jewish history, came not long ago. Until the end of the Soviet period, the Soviet regime tried everything in its power in order to cover the predominantly Jewish content of this event, you know, and only in the late 1980s people started to understand that it's first something which is attributed to the Jewish destiny in the Eastern Europe. So you see neo-Nazi actually found the symbol of new understanding of the massacres of the Holocaust in order to put swastika on it. The second example is something which goes along the background of probably religious anti-Semitism. Here you see oil, a tent, you know, a construction over the tomb of religious or authorities or people important in the religious history of the Eastern Europe. This is the tomb of daughters of Rabbi Nachman Mibreslov. Rabbi Nachman of Breslov, one of the important, used to be not so important, but at the moment, pretty important subculture in the contemporary neo-Orthodox Judaism. So you see that it was more vandalized. And what is interesting here, that's actually a Holocaust memorial in Novomoskovsk. The inscriptions here, you know, graffiti here, are actually not neo-fascist. But in fact, much more dealing with the Soviet-style ideology, the so-called neo-communist movement, which actually believes that Jews are those who destroyed the Soviet Union and made this country to be transformed from the world empire, world superpower, into the current situation. So from this point of view, we can say that Judaphobia is serving political interests in that country. All sorts of hostilities among Jews very much related to what is defined as their media anti-Semitism. Please have a look that only in the first half of the last year, the authorities removed 4,500 anti-Semitic sites and closed blocked about 800 of such sites, including those who were raising funds and recruiting activists for radical Islamic extremist organizations. So that what was closed, we can understand that probably 3, 4, 5, 7 folds, nobody knows how many, how many more, you know, how much more are actually still active. The new media, like Facebook, like internet, opens a lot of space for what we call public proclamations of the anti-Semitic feelings. In fact, we could stress several points for this media anti-Semitism. They are talking about imminent unloyalty of Jews to the Russian state. they're talking about Jews are always ready for hostile actions for Slavs and other groups in the Soviet, in the Russian society. A lot of stuff of the Holocaust revisionism, a lot of stuff is twisting around in the networks. And of course, the absolutely new one, denial of Israel, so-called neo-Zionism as anti-Semitism, a pretty new one, which was, as we thought, abolished at the end of the Soviet era. The Soviet regime was anti-Zionist. So the way to remove the Soviet past was actually a good approach to Israel. If you are going to depart from a classical Soviet ideology, that means we should accept what was rejected. And in 1990s, only 2000, actually, that's what happened, you know, a positive view of Israel, Jews who were emigrating to the West, or especially making Aliyah to Israel, were not seen as betrayers of the Mother Russia anymore. That happens only recently. So-called anti-Zionist stream within the titular nation, within the Slav population, not necessarily the Muslim population, population of Russia. Still, I must say that the research of recent research of Levada Center shows that 2% of the Russian population see Israel as a friend, and 2% of the Russian population see Israel as an enemy. That means more than 95% believe they have pretty not stressed idea concerning the state of Israel. And if they are asked to put it in their in the rating, you know, the friends and foes of the Russian Federation, so much more people see Israel as a friend. Then they see Ukraine as a friend, Georgia as a friend, United States as a friend, and even Estonia as a friend. So Estonia as a foe, and Israel as a friend. Okay, but that means that meantime, it's not an issue for the Russian population, but it's already there, you know. It's still latent, suppressed, but it can rise the case the government will see profitable. And of course, a Jewish card in politics. I even didn't have time to translate it from Russia into from Russian into English. I would say that, for instance, the government, the top rank officials, are not anti-Semites. At least in operative point of view. But in various regions, these are their bureaucrats, these are their governors. That they may use the Jewish card in terms of serving their political interests. For instance. One of our respondents, or their respondents, explained, defined the activity of one of their governors in the Dagestan, you know, in the local Dagestanian region. So he said, when Chechens, he mind Chechen radical activists, then they attacked Dagestan, the leader of the region approached the journalists and started to talk not about what actually happened and why that happened, concerning the reason, look for the reasons from inside, you know, looking for the reasons within the society, but rather started to explain about international Zionist centers in New York and Jerusalem that are trying to promote the instability in this region of the Russian Federation. Why Zionist centers? What they have to do with this, and nobody asking questions, you know. Why to ask these questions? That's that he believes, you know. Maybe he's a personal anti-Semite, but it's much more important for him that he, at the moment, he has a ready explanation. All the problems are because of these Zionist centers. But that's already touched upon a little bit, different aspects of political anti-Semitism. I'm not going to elaborate it anymore. But as I said, the Jewish aspect of Russian-Ukrainian crisis is in fact one of the reasons of the fact that all these anti-Semitic ideas are on. They are broadcasted. Regardless the fact that at the moment this is Moscow which tries to excuse or blame Ukrainians for anti-Semitism and Ukrainians trying to blame Russians for anti-Semitism, the very fact that is discussed is actually increases this latent suppressed anti-Semitic feelings opening the way of transformation into anti-Semitic understandings, and in future might be also activities. What are the anti-Semitic stereotypes which we are identified in this research? The same story, you know, traditional story. Jews rule the Russia and the world. We ask the question, people ask question, whether you could imagine a Jew ruling Russia, meaning becoming president, prime minister. The answer was shocking. Why I should imagine something? They're actually ruling Russia. And that happened all the time. A young guy from Khabarovsk, Siberia, Lenin. Lenin was Jewish. All of his members of his government were Jewish, half-Jewish, quarter Jews, practically all of them. Lenin, it was him who established the State of Israel. Of course, not alone, with the help of Stalin. Yeltsin is Jewish. Medvedev is Jewish. By the way, I've heard that Vladimir Vladimirovich Putin is also Jewish. They say that he's also a Mason. We could make laugh of that, you know. It's really funny. It's amusing. But let us not to forget, ladies and gentlemen, that this is inside. That's what people think. It doesn't have any, at the moment, it doesn't have any operative meaning. That people believe, sometimes some of them even think that it's good, you know. Okay, Russians are in power, that might be neither good nor bad. And some of them might believe that it's even good, you know. Israel became a concept, became a brand, especially in countries like Ukraine, Moldova, Azerbaijan, and sometimes even in Russia. So okay, Jews came, Jews rule, maybe something good will come out of that. But we all understand that it might change dramatically in no time. The question was what is specifically Russian in this context, which actually that's what we saw in the Soviet times and the previous periods. As I said, the answer is the following. The contemporary Russian government is ideology of the Russian government is a combination of three narratives, including pre-communist Tsarist Russia, Soviet power, and the contemporary so-called pro-Western liberal approach, like a descendants of the dissident democratic movement. So at the moment, what we see here, why it is important for contemporary Russian context, that means that it is part of the public discourse, that it's something very inner, very inside. Anti-Semitism or anti-Semitism, these beliefs are a part of the world vision and the public culture, which should take into account. On the other hand, the government at the moment is not interested to use it. On the contrary, non-authorized proclamations of anti-Semitism, unless they're you know, recruited on of the demand, are forbidden. At the moment, government, and especially due to the fact that Putin is personally, as I said, probably not anti-Semite at all, so they're interested to use the Jewish card on the way back, you know. So it's not just a populist. It might be a populist, but on the other hand, Russia is using tens of thousands of people every year, or hundreds of thousands. The Russian population is decreasing. So the way to stop this process is either to promote fertility, which is pretty difficult, or to return so-called those who are part of the Russian culture, or ethnic Russians, or those who are bearers of the Russian culture, bring them back to Russia. Among them, first of all, of course, those who are Russian-speaking population from the former Soviet republics, like Ukraine, Kazakhstan, Belarus, Baltic states, and so on and forth, so forth. Coming back of Jews to Russia, on the symbolic level, is very important. If Jews are coming back to Russia, that means that Russia has is a prosperous state which has a future. By the way, the same story we have in Ukraine. One of the elements of this Jewish card in the political anti-Semitism of blaming each other is to explain to the whole world that Jews are with us. They are supporting our side in the conflict. For Ukrainians, for instance, the fact that the Jews are actually fighting in the front against separatists in the eastern Ukraine, that the Ukraine has good relations with Israel, that Israel is planning or developing very good intimate mutual relations with Ukraine, in fact, to explain to the whole world that we are doing right thing. Okay, the same story is in Russia. So it's much more, again, it's much more policy there rather than anti-Semitism. But it could be, could come together very easily, as I say, in a night, in no time, that could happen. Well, other elements of that, Jews captured power and all goods, you know. Jews still insist that they are chosen people. That's something which is relates to the sources of traditional anti-Semitism. The question was whether it spread geographically. What's the difference between big population centers and provinces? And whether Jews are a concept or real persons that one could love or hate. So that's really the difference between big population centers, Moscow and St. Petersburg, where in fact you have an interface. Jews and non-Jews do have an interface, meet each other. Outside the big population centers, the Jewish community is very small, if it exists at all. For the majority of the Russian population, Jews much more a concept than real people. So a Jew, or what they know about a Jew, is a part of the local folklore, if you understand what I mean. And when they meet the real Jew, they quite often don't recognize him as a Jew or her. That means he's much more like any other there. Several times I faced the situation that people told me that you couldn't be Jewish, you know, you are not a Jew. You are not like that, you know. So it's, you are not this, meeting all these dimensions of this folklore, Jewish personage with all these abilities and features of character attributed to the Jewish people. So again, we could define it as a-Semitism rather than anti-Semitism, but it really depends. It's very easy to come to these people and to say, okay, you know, this guy is Jewish, and that is why everything happens because of his activities or this group of people, and so on and so forth. But at the moment, you are right. Yes, we have a strict difference between center and periphery. Jews are greedy and tricky. Okay, that's traditional. In many cases, many of the people I taught in the village school at the beginning of my teaching career, in eastern Ukraine. Sometimes after at the end of the first my first academic year at school, by whatever reason I don't know, I said to somebody that I am Jewish. He said, "No, it cannot be so. You are not greedy and not tricky." They have never seen a live Jew, you know, in their life. So it's as I said, you know, it's much more a folklore personage. But that could be for good and for bad. You know, for bad it could be that you don't know real Jew, how they like, what they like, and these people could be explained and persuaded in anything. For instance, you probably know, some of colleagues here probably remember a very symptomatic phenomenon. A couple of years ago, there was a mishpat, the case, a court case of a guy, a village teacher, like me many years ago, who came to a distant village in the provincial Russia. He's Jewish, he was Jewish, and tried to combine his academic activity with their working in the public sphere, in the culture sphere. Open circles for children and teach them art and education and so on and so forth. Yeah? And he was blamed for mismanagement of the public funds used for this, you know. And when he was brought before the court and was trying to explain that in fact he was going to help, he did as much in his power as to do better and never thought that he's doing something wrong. The procurator, you know, the attorney, you say,
prosecutor.
The public prosecutor said, okay, a person with a name like you cannot do that. if he doesn't keep in mind a personal interest. So that's, you know, that's not somebody, a peasant in the distant Siberia village that have never seen anything in his life, you know. That's a public prosecutor, an educated person, probably got his education in one of the big population centers. That could be okay. The good news is that the whole Russian society discussed it. And Mr. Putin said that it's pretty unacceptable world vision, you know. And many people of this government said the same. But it is there, if you understand what I mean. So, and of course, they are lacking patriotism. At the moment, they are Russian patriots because it's good for them. But tomorrow they become, they could stop being Russian patriots if it also will be profitable. That's among their ideas. Okay, let me to conclude, to summarize. As you can see, first of all, there is a decrease of state anti-Semitism and anti-Semitic violence. That's the fact. That's the simple fact. Second, we still have between 8 to 10% of the Russian society which could be defined as a strong core for classical anti-Semitism. Third, there is quite a substantial group of people who are, might be defined as the part of having feelings of so-called suppressed, latent, or sleeping anti-Semitism. Fourth, on the operational level, as I said at the beginning of my lecture, and I hope I did prove that, this is, doesn't bring an immediate risk and challenge to the well-being of their Russian Jewish community in that country. At least it's much less than might economic difficulties or political instability. But it may change in future. And if the government would decide to use the Jewish card against Jews, that would probably find an understanding in the public opinion. And what is left for us is just to hope that it will never happen. Well, that's more or less what I was going to say today. Thank you very much. Thanks for coming.
We would be pleased to send a complimentary DVD of this program to anyone who wishes to support JBS, the Jewish Broadcasting Service, with a tax-deductible gift of $36, double chai, or more, to the nonprofit organization Jewish Education in Media. Simply visit the JBS homepage and click on the Donate button to make a donation by PayPal or your credit card. And please indicate the program for which you would like a DVD. Or you can send your tax-deductible check made out to JEM, Post Office Box 180, Riverdale Station, Bronx, New York, 10471. And again, please remember to indicate which program you would like to receive with our compliments. And we thank you for your kind support.